Once upon a time, there was a coffee table. It had a cool, biomorphic shape, a heavy plate glass top, and curved wooden legs. It lived alongside Ames chairs, kidney-shaped pools, Chet Baker, and Take Five. Today, that table is known as the Noguchi Coffee Table. I grew up in the 1960s with one of those tables. Although, to set the record straight, it was a Noguchi knockoff, walnut top instead of glass. To me, it went alongside the Flintstones and the Jetsons, Gilligan's Island, and Honey West. Around our house, the table was known as the "Don't put your feet up on the coffee table. No, don't even lean on it. It will tip and the vase will fall over and break, or you'll spill something all over the carpet" coffee table. Maybe I should have come to dislike that table for the many times it caused me to spill and get into trouble. But I never lost my affection for it. I guess some things are just too great to hate. It was only much later that I learned it wasn't just me who thought that coffee table was cool, that the table even had a name. So recently, I got to wondering, who was this Noguchi who designed the Too Great to Hate table? I remembered the name Thomas Noguchi, the Los Angeles coroner who investigated the deaths of Marilyn Monroe, Robert Kennedy, and Janis Joplin. Were the coroner and the coffee table designer related? Or even the same man? I hit the internet and the library and started my search. His name was Isamu Noguchi, and he was not, spoiler alert, related to Thomas the coroner. His father, Yoni Noguchi, was a Japanese poet. His mother, Leonie Gilmore, was an American writer and educator, and a descendant of the petroleum-producing Gilmore oil family. She met Yoni Noguchi in Los Angeles in 1901 when she answered an ad to assist a Japanese poet with his English. The two never married, but they had one child. They named him Isamu. Isamu was raised first in Los Angeles, then Japan, then back to the U.S. for high school and college. He dropped out of Columbia University in 1924 to pursue sculpture full-time. After leaving college, Noguchi traveled the world, from Italy and France to Japan, China, and India. Artistically and intellectually curious, he studied with Brancusi in Paris, designed sets for Martha Graham in New York, and had an affair with Frida Kahlo in Mexico. He hung out with Buckminster Fuller and Alexander Calder and the rest of the modernist crew. He worked in metal, stone, wood, mixed media, and clay. He crafted bas-reliefs and lamps. In the lean times, he created busts for wealthy patrons. Noguchi developed a versatile aesthetic that drew inspiration from prehistoric bones, Zen gardens, and surrealism. "Everything is sculpture," became Noguchi's mantra. And slowly, through many years of ups and downs, he became an internationally acclaimed sculptor. Noguchi was particularly committed to creating large-scale public works. He designed gardens, bridges, fountains, and playgrounds around the world. Today, his sculpture dots the globe, from New York and Paris to Japan, Jerusalem, Munich, and Detroit. When he died in 1988, the New York Times obit called Noguchi's work landmarks of 20th century art, but no mention of his coffee table. In the biography of Noguchi that I read, his coffee table, major cool icon of modernist design, makes a cameo appearance of exactly one short paragraph. The coffee table turned out to be just a minor footnote in the life of a prolific, influential, internationally renowned artist. But, as I was about to discover, it was a footnote drenched in an unexpected history. After the attack on Pearl Harbor, with the United States now at war with Japan and racist fears swelling, the U.S. government ordered all Japanese Americans on the West Coast into relocation camps, which were being rapidly built throughout the West. Because Noguchi lived on the East Coast, he was not required to move into a camp. He recalled in his memoirs,
"Pearl Harbor was an unmitigated shock, forcing into the background all artistic activities. With a flash, I realized that I was no longer a sculptor alone. I was not just American, but Nisei, second generation Japanese American. I felt I must do something."
Not a joiner by nature, Noguchi nevertheless organized Nisei Writers and Artists for Democracy. Enlisting the support of cultural heavyweights like Pearl Buck and Kerry McWilliams, he sought to counter the hysteria against Japanese Americans and to stop their impending imprisonment. He spoke before congressional committees, the War Relocation Authority, and the State Department, but he encountered only closed minds. Finally, he met with John Collier, head of the Office of Indian Affairs. A relocation center was being constructed on an Indian reservation in Arizona. Collier invited Noguchi to live in that camp, where he could teach arts and crafts to the prisoners and work on improving the camp environment. Noguchi accepted the challenge. Other Nisei he spoke with about his plans told him he was nuts. Noguchi arrived in Poston, Arizona in May 1942. The relocation center was situated in the middle of the desert. It was blazing hot. Barbed wire fencing and watchtowers with machine guns and night searchlights surrounded the camp. Along with the other prisoners, the sculptor waited in long lines for lousy food and slept in roasting tar paper-walled barracks. He did have his own room, however, which created jealousy and resentment among the other prisoners. Most unsettling for Noguchi, he received from the camp administration virtually zero support, tools, or materials for his programs. Despite the dispiriting atmosphere, Noguchi was determined to use his skills for the betterment of his fellow Nisei. Encouraged by John Collier, he designed an overall plan for the camp. The plan included parks, a baseball field, swimming pool, cemetery, and irrigation system. However, it soon became obvious to Noguchi that the authorities had no intention of implementing any of his ideas. In a letter to his friend, the artist Man Ray, he wrote,
"This is the weirdest, most unusual situation. I wish I were out. Here, time has stopped, and nothing is of any consequence, nothing of any value, neither our time or our skill."
While living at Poston, Noguchi was allowed to receive newspapers and magazines. One day, in a magazine, he came across an advertisement for a three-legged coffee table. The table was shockingly similar to one Noguchi had designed for that furniture company several years earlier. But now, it was being marketed without his knowledge or monetary compensation. He immediately contacted the company. Their response was, essentially, tough luck. Noguchi seethed, but locked up in a prison camp, he was impotent to do anything about it. Noguchi wanted out more than ever, but it proved to be much easier to get into a prison camp than to get out. He first approached the director of the War Relocation Authority, asking for immediate release. However, due to what was suddenly considered his suspicious activity, such as organizing Nisei Writers and Artists for Democracy, his request was denied. Next, he appealed to the camp director. No go. He wrote letters to John Collier, his advocate at the Office of Indian Affairs. Collier relayed his request to the military authorities. The months rolled by. In September 1942, some prisoners of mixed ancestry were allowed out of Poston on temporary leave to visit relatives or work in the fields. Noguchi was not on the list. He became increasingly upset. What had once been a voluntary imprisonment was now anything but. Finally, on November 12, 1942, after months of requests, pleadings, and bureaucratic complexities, Isamu Noguchi was granted a short-term furlough. He walked out of the gate of the relocation center, got into his car, and drove north across the desert. He never returned. After leaving the Poston prison camp, Noguchi moved back to New York. When his 30-day leave expired, the U.S. government granted him a permanent leave. At his Greenwich Village studio, he began a series of biomorphic sculptures, which became some of his signature work. In 1951, he married Japanese actress Yoshiko Yamaguchi. The couple made their home on the outskirts of Tokyo, and while the marriage lasted only 5 years, Noguchi would live part-time in Japan for the rest of his life. But earlier, back in 1947, not long after the war had ended, Noguchi designed a three-legged coffee table for the Herman Miller Furniture Company. The coffee table sold well, and the rest is design history.